Hello and welcome to the Fossil of the Day Awards Paris Agreement 5th Anniversary Special Edition. For those of you who do not know, the Fossil of the Day is an award presented each day inside the UN climate negotiations to the country or countries who are the best at being the worst, who are doing the most to do the least, and who are trying day and night to ensure that the world does not reach a fair, just, and binding climate agreement. As you may have noticed, this year's ceremony, like everything else in 2020, is being held online. And tonight, we'll be looking back upon not just the past year, but on the past 5 years since the signing of the historic Paris Agreement, and looking back at how far we've come, or haven't, in that time. Our next award category is for the country who has done the most not to live up to their 1.5 degree commitment. As we mentioned earlier, the 1.5 degree target represents a red line for the safety of humanity. And its inclusion in the Paris text was a big fight. Around the COP21 summit, it was the strong voices and actions by civil society and small island states, both inside and outside the conference, that built enough public pressure to keep this vital target in the text. And now that the 1.5 target has been agreed, the question of how to get there is up for grabs. This gap between what science demands and what politics says is possible is called the production gap. Countries are still planning to produce far more fossil fuels by 2030 than is consistent with the needs of our planet. And looking at post-COVID recovery plans and national climate targets, all indications are that governments are planning to expand fossil fuel production at precisely the time when we should be winding it down. And the 2020 award for not honoring the 1.5 commitment goes to Australia. Australia wins this award for so many reasons. Notably, it does not have a net zero by 2050 target. It's the world's largest exporter of both coal and gas, and it has massive plans to expand fracking across sovereign Aboriginal territory. Australia wins this award for so many reasons. Notably, it does not have a net zero by 2050 target. It's the world's largest exporter of both coal and gas, and it has massive plans to expand fracking across sovereign Aboriginal territory. This is pretty ironic coming from a country who's been reported to be one of the most climate vulnerable places on Earth, where exceeding 1.5 degrees would be the final nail in the coffin for the Great Barrier Reef. Not to mention all the devastating fires we saw last year that ravaged Australia and affected a terrifying 4 billion animals. Poor, poor koalas. And this brings us to our next fossil acronym, GKP, which obviously stands for Global Koala Population, which I would argue is perhaps a better way to judge global progress than GDP, as it's based upon the abundance of arguably our planet's cutest creature, which is the Global Koala Index. And Australia's cruel negligence around climate action is taking a big blow to the GKP, which, really, considering it's the only country on the planet with these lovable, huggable marsupials, is an issue that really concerns all of us. So we might wonder if perhaps the entire issue of global GKP security might not be best left to a country whose prime minister actually held up a piece of coal in parliament and said, "This is coal, do not be afraid." Well, Scott Morrison, I am afraid. I'm very afraid. When I see images of flaming wombats fleeing in terror, I get afraid. I get very afraid. Because this is 2020. No matter what we do now, things are still going to get a lot worse before 2050. First, let's talk about the net zero by 2050 target. And the most important thing to know about net zero targets is that it's a lot can fit into that wide net, including all sorts of loony emissions trading and carbon capture and storage schemes, which are dangerous distractions to real emissions reductions. So make sure to remember, net zero is not the same as zero. Nonetheless, this is a benchmark that nearly all developed nations, including China, have gathered behind. 70% of Australia's own trade now goes to countries with net zero targets, and every Australian state and territory has adopted net zero by 2050 or earlier, as well as all major business coalitions and many cities across the country. it almost seems like all of Australia is on board with the net zero by 2050 target, except its own national government. Does that mean they're gonna have to like move all the coal plants and fracking rigs directly inside the parliament building and prime minister's office? With all those coal plants in there, it's gonna get smoky. But maybe that's part of their plan so that no one will see what's actually going on. But this lack of long-term target is significant because it basically means Australia has no long-term climate plan that in any way resembles sanity. They're not even doing what most other countries are doing of hiding behind some faraway target and saying like, oh yeah, 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 net zero by 2050 thing, fantastic, we're gonna start working in 2045 and we think it'll be no problem. The urgent need for both long and short-term climate ambition is pretty apparent in a country that literally lost 18 million hectares of bush and forest last year, not to mention the devastating repeated droughts that ravaged the world's largest island nation, all of which have very serious effects on our GKP. And get this, Australia is taking their own Paris commitments to keep global temperatures to 1.5 degrees pretty lightly, considering a recent study found that Australia has already warmed 1.4 degrees Celsius since 1910. They are putting a lot of faith in that remaining 0.1 degree, considering, again, how seriously this all affects GKP. Who will we hug, Australia, when all the koalas are gone? Who will we hug? So now that we know what Australia's climate target isn't, let's look at what it is. Currently, the land down under is aiming towards 26 to 28% reductions from 2005 levels by 2030, which is roughly about half of what the world is calling on them to adopt. So how does Australia get away with all this despite its catastrophic consequences for GKP? Well, this issue draws attention to one of the crucial problems around international climate negotiations based on emissions. Because Australia is the world's largest coal and gas exporter, and it's kind of crazy, if you think about it, that they can be the largest exporter of two of the leading causes of global greenhouse gas emissions and still be like, oh yeah, yeah, we just sell the stuff. We didn't think they'd burn it. You know, we just thought that we were sending all that coal to China so that they'd make lots of charcoal drawing pencils or something. And that fracking methane, oh, it's all just decorative. I mean, we have laws against drugs and drug dealing. They don't catch you with a bag of cocaine, and when you're like, oh no, 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 it's not for me, I'm gonna sell it. They're like, oh, okay, well, on your merry way, son. Thank you for helping the economy. The issue of demand-side emissions is one of the primary ways in which countries such as Australia retain the profits from fossil fuel extraction, but pass the emissions on to other countries with far lower historic emissions. Australia's greenhouse gas emissions from its exports are more than double its domestic emissions, making their responsibility towards climate action even greater. In response to their reprehensible action, just last week, former presidents, prime ministers, and religious leaders from across small island Pacific nations, some of the countries most vulnerable to climate impacts, sent a letter to Prime Minister Scott Morrison saying, and I quote, to save their culture from certain devastation from climate change, and asking Australia to stand together as their children and grandchildren face unprecedented risks. Dude. When your neighbors send you a letter saying, please stop what you're doing, it's going to kill our children, you better think closely about how you respond. Or maybe you pack up and move back where you came from. Remember, they were there first. And what Australia does in response to these urgent calls for more ambition in their response to the climate crisis is not just a national matter. As countries scramble to transform their economies in response to the economic impacts of the global COVID-19 pandemic, it seems Australia is choosing to dig itself further into a hole by trying to frack its way back to economic growth. Australia's national government is placing its bets on fossil gas, despite it being such an economically fragile industry that not even industry will pay to get free methane from beneath the soil. Australia has allocated billions of dollars to fast-track new fracking projects across areas the majority of which have native titles, such as the Beetaloo Basin and the Galilee Basin, and across the country are facing powerful and totally legitimate pushback from the original keepers of these lands, who have quite happily lived here for tens of thousands of years without ever feeling the dire need to use explosives to fracture the crust of the earth, to release the most dangerous greenhouse gas stored beneath, and then try to catch whatever they can of it while that pure methane jumps straight up into the atmosphere. Well, mate, unfortunately, that might be the kind of pandemic response you expect when you put gas executives in charge of the national COVID recovery plan. And look, I'm not an economist, but if you have to use billions of dollars of public money to pay private corporations to do something because it's so economically unviable, I don't think that's called economic recovery. I think that's called building stranded assets. And remember that all of these fracking wells keep leaking methane straight into the atmosphere for decades after they've stopped being economically productive, which again has very serious impacts on our GKP. So without further ado, we turn to Amelin for some more information on this. Amelin, on to you.
Wow, thank you so much. I'm really honored to receive this on the behalf of Australia. What an honor.
Congrats. All right. So who are you and why do you think Australia deserves this award?
My name's Manjot Kerr. I'm 19 years old and I'm from a small coal community in New South Wales in Australia. I'm currently a uni student and I'm really excited to receive this award because, you know, all those years I've spent in activism against climate change, all those protests I attended, all those people I talked to outside of voting booths, I did because I wanted a government to listen. But they haven't been taking action on climate change and we are currently heading towards much more than 1.5. And so that's why I'm really excited to accept this award to really highlight and celebrate Australia's lack of inaction.
Ooh, that sounds amazing. Australia definitely hasn't been doing a lot and not committing to the whole 1.5 issue. But what do you think that y'all could be doing so you don't have to receive this award in the future?
The thing is, even if Scott Morrison and our government has forgotten about the climate emergency, has forgotten about the bushfires, because that's the only thing I can imagine with the how he's ignoring it, I think Australians have not forgotten what this means. And that's why I'm accepting this award. I have not forgotten what it means to go on a drive with my friends and to think we're seeing the sunset and then to realize it's a wall of flame and smoke in the background. I have not forgotten what it feels like to be stranded on a train station in the mountains because the train tracks aren't safe because of the bushfire and I can't get reception to call my father to pick me up from 2 hours away.
So thanks so much, Manoj. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Despite 26 years of negotiations, each year we are still further away from where we need to be, with emissions steadily rising, extinction rates skyrocketing into unimaginable levels, extraction and climate impacts affecting the world's population who have benefited the least from wrecking our planet. And the fact that in the past 5 years has become very, very obvious just how bad the climate crisis already is. Surely fossil fuels have been essential for making the world what it is. But is this really the best we can do? That world is not going to be easy, but it's going to require all of us holding our public institutions accountable and taking down private institutions who aren't, and demanding a swift, deep, and truly transformational just transition. Our decisions today will transform the human story, and the Paris Agreement, signed exactly 5 years ago today, is a testament to our entangled collectivity here aboard Spaceship Earth. Thank you so much for joining us today for the Fossil of the Day Paris Agreement 5th Anniversary Special Edition. And see you next year at the COP26 in Glasgow.